Madness! Ah! What's going on, guys? Oh, I'm so excited for this for you guys. This is actually the second edition of Tracking the Madness. It is February 22nd of 2013. I'm Jack. I'm really excited. As you guys know, I posted my first video, kind of an update toward last week, actually early this week, on what this channel was going to be kind of its focus on now, and it's about gearing up for March Madness. I am so excited. This is one of my favorite times of year. I'm watching basketball pretty much nonstop almost, watching the teams that are kind of under the radar, of course watching the big name teams, the bubble teams. You know, this who's in, who's out debate. It's great stuff, and I'm just so pumped for it. And I am ready. This is hot off the press. I just now printed this. This is my latest Fearson 68 projection. I will also post this on my Facebook notes, as I always do. But I will post it there as well. And so I'll share with you guys the matchups that I have, why I have some teams in, some teams out, the bubble debate. Reasons why teams are in or out. So let's just jump right in. As you guys know, kind of the way that, you know, like I say, I try to and I follow the committee ground rules, I guess, as much as I possibly can. I actually try to make it pretty close to how the selection committee does it. Because last year, the NCAA did a great thing last year. They actually let people in kind of take a behind the scenes inside look into the selection process. What they did was they showed you like how they do the seeding, how they put the teams together, how they choose. They gave people access to every single like team sheet or cheat sheet that the NCAA uses. Every team's resume was on there. You could have access to it, and it was the coolest thing. So you could see what the NCAA uses to make these really difficult selections. I love doing the bracketology. I love doing this. But for me to actually be a committee member in that room, I'm sure there'd be some stressful times. I can't imagine myself fighting over a team. Why don't you have California in the field? You know, what are you putting St. John's there? You know, that it'd be juicy, but I don't know if I could handle that. I'd have to have like two bottles of Gatorade or something sitting here in front of me. Let me tell you why Cal is in the field. You know, it'd be the funniest thing probably. But I love it. It's just so entertaining, that debate, to be jacked. And I mentioned maybe last week, or maybe I mentioned or on the last video, or if not, I'm going to mention it now. I feel like the biggest disagreeer between my projections and anyone else is Joe Lunardi of ESPN. Now, don't get me wrong. I love Lunardi. He was like probably the first big name bracketologist to come out there. And I know other guys have been doing it before, but Lunardi is probably the one that really a lot of people look at when it comes to bracket projections. But man, sometimes I can't understand why he has some teams in and some teams out. What is Lunardi looking at? What is he looking at? Does he look at the whole body of work? Does he look at the recent games? Does he look at all of this? Because, for example, right now, like last night, he had California out and they had done nothing to warrant themselves being out. Now he has them back in because they beat Oregon. But it's like, why are they out? And why is St. John's on his last four out list? First four out list? Why are they even being considered? St. John's resume is not that great. They have double digit losses. They're 15-10, for gosh sake. That's like barely above 500. Why are they being considered? Why is Southern Miss out when their RPI went up after they beat UTEP? So I know a lot of questions. I know I got off tangent there ranting about Lunardi and why he says what he says, but to me it's like we are the Mel Kiper Jr. and Todd McShay of bracketology. Here's why I'm right. No, here's why I'm right. We always have these disagreements. Okay. I'm ready to share this with you guys. I'm ready to share my recent projection of what I have And after I share the matchups with you guys and who I have, I will also share with you guys my last four in, my first four out, and the whole bubble debate. Who are my should be in teams? Who are my, by conference, who is close but not, or who's in the field but not safe right now, and then who's really the true bubble teams that have a lot to worry about in the weeks to come. All right. Starting with the one line, the top line of top seeds. Obviously, right now, I think three are pretty much locked into the one line at the moment. That's obviously Indiana, who's still number one in the country. Miami, who is just absolutely dominating the ACC this year. Jim Larrañaga has done an awesome job with Miami. I mean, heck, he took a mid-major in George Mason to the 06 Final Four. And what he's doing with Miami this year is absolutely amazing. Now, granted, that cloud of the allegations hangs over the program, the university as a whole, but what he's doing is absolutely amazing. And Duke. Duke, obviously, I'm not a fan of Duke, never have been, but I got to admit, good team, well-coached, and talented players, although a little bit cocky and arrogant, but well-coached team. The other number one is really up for debate. Some people have Gonzaga on the one line, and I don't question Gonzaga. I have watched Gonzaga play. They are a very strong team. Heck, they destroyed. I watched their game against Santa Clara. They absolutely destroyed Santa Clara, and I barely had Santa Clara on like a team that was on the bubble list. They were a long shot, but they were on the list. After that game, Santa Clara fell off the list because they did not show anything against that game. Gonzaga completely dominated them. Obviously, so Gonzaga is definitely much in the discussion for the one line, but right now I do have Florida as that fourth number one team. I know they lost, and I know they lost to Missouri, but really, you can't fault Florida for that loss because A, it was at Missouri. B, Missouri's been dominant at home this season. They're perfect at home still. And Florida's I think the more major conference of the two. So I have Florida as the fourth number one. So right now it's Indiana, Miami, Duke, and Florida for me as the number one seeds. All right, so let's go by region. Midwest region, I have Indiana, obviously the overall number one. They would play the winner of Norfolk State and Southern. Now, Norfolk State, if you'll recall, last year, they were kind of one of the big upset stories at the tourney. They were the 15 seed that upset Missouri in the first round. Now, granted, they got their hat handed to them by Florida in the second round, or the third round. See, that's the thing. That's another problem I have now. We call these now the first four is now called the first round, and then the rest of the games are called second round and third round. That's so confusing. but anyway, I digress. But Norfolk State, they beat Missouri, and that was just Norfolk State shot the lights out that game, and they were very impressive in just stunning a very talented Missouri team, which is still talented this year. But then Florida gave them a dose of reality. But Norfolk State is rolling through the MEAC conference. They are MEAC conference. MEAC. I just said MEAC, Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference. I always do that. But the MEAC, Norfolk State's rolling through it. Very good team. And Southern right now is leading the SWAC, which usually tends to be the weakest conference of the smaller mid-major conferences, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. They usually end up in the play-in game anyway, or one of the four. So it really wouldn't be a shocker if whoever comes out of there. There's a couple teams chasing Southern for the conference race right now. I know Arkansas Pine Bluff's very close. So there's another team there. I think Texas Southern. So there's a couple teams close, but right now that would be the two teams that I have for that play-in game, the winner to play IU. Now, if Norfolk State were to win that game, would I see another upset there? Well, again, history tells us 16 has never beaten a 1 in NCAA play. Will it eventually happen? I mean, I think, in terms of the history things, we like to see history happen. So I would say a lot of people would say, yeah, they'd like to see it happen at least once. That way it's done. But a lot of people would say, the purists would say, no, the ones just show how dominant they are. And there definitely becomes teams that have come close. I think the closest a 16 has come is 2 points. Or even 1 point, I think. So I think it's going to happen eventually. I just don't know when it's going to happen, but I think it'll happen at some point. And considering the parity this year, it may very well be this year. The 8-9 matchup, I have two kind of mid-major programs here. I have San Diego State of the Mountain West going up against Wichita State, who would get the automatic bid from the Missouri Valley. Wichita State has been a very entertaining. Missouri Valley always seems to be a fun conference to watch. The conference tournament's always exciting. The teams play really hard. And just a very fun conference to watch. Wichita State, I mean, I think they're 3-0 against the top 50 this season, which is really huge. That gives them a lot of momentum going into the postseason. But same with the Mountain West. The Mountain West is probably going to get at least four teams in the field this year, maybe even five. So again, this would be a battle of really two kind of very strong mid-major conferences going up against each other in that 8-9 matchup. My 5-12, also kind of a mid-major battle, but one that really doesn't play like a mid-major. My five in this region is Butler, out of the A-10. Butler, what they have done the last few years, Brad Stevens has done an amazing job as coach, leading the Bulldogs to the national championship game the last 2 years. Granted, losing both times, although they almost beat Duke 2 years ago, that Gordon Hayward shot, if you'll recall. But what they have done for their school, for the state of Indiana, where basketball here is huge, it's just been so outstanding. And now, even though they moved from the smaller Horizon League into the A-10, Butler's still competing, and that's and we knew the conference would be tougher for them as a whole, but Butler's still showing they can compete with the best of them. They've got some great wins this season. Beat Gonzaga in that thrilling game. Beat Marquette this year. So just they still compete, folks. They're still the real deal. And I have them going up against Southern Miss out of Conference USA. Southern Miss is probably right now one of those kind of last teams that really gets into the field for me. They really haven't done a lot. Their resume on paper isn't all that great. They don't have a top 50 win to speak of. They're 0-3. But they did record a nice top 100 win recently against UTEP, which bumped their RPI and their numbers up. So for me, that's what really right now barely gets Southern Miss in the field. They were also helped by the fact that Baylor, who was a team that I did have in the field, lost to Iowa State, and that to me took Baylor out of the field. So, in fact, I think they are one of my first four out. So for now, that puts Southern Miss in the field just barely. They're certainly not safe by any stretch because they'd like to maybe get some wins. They don't really have a whole lot. The problem is they're scheduling a whole lot of opportunities ahead for them to get some quality wins. They have to beat Memphis in the rematch, I think. I think that, and that's tomorrow. I think that game is huge for Southern Miss for their bubble chances to get into the field. If they don't win that game, it's really tough. They probably have to win out, win at least a couple games in the COSA tourney, maybe even get to the final and beat Memphis again if it comes down to that. So, gotta beat Memphis. Gotta get some quality wins on your resume. Otherwise, it might not be looking good. Even though they're a 20-plus win team, they have 21 wins this season. But that doesn't always guarantee that you get into the field. Just ask Missouri State a couple years ago, some other 20-win teams that haven't made the field. And my 4-13 in that region is Kansas State of the Big 12 going up against Akron of the MAC. Now, excuse me. Now, Kansas State has also been a very fun team to watch this year out of the Big 12. They've got some really they managed to find some talented players every year, it seems like. And even though Frank Martin, who I loved watching as coach, he's a very aggressive coach, left. I don't know who's called, sorry, but I can't do that right now. But Kansas State, very entertaining. And so, but now they got the, I think they got, who did they get? They got the guy from Illinois. Bruce Weber, and he is just doing a great job at Kansas State, but I haven't played this Akron team who's just rolling through the Mid-American Conference right now. And Akron has a big game tonight in Bracket Busters. They have to play North Dakota State, who's looking pretty strong in the Summit League. So that'll be a fun game to watch at 7 o'clock tonight, by the way. But Akron is, I think they're still undefeated in conference play in the MAC, which is a great accomplishment to go undefeated through your conference. So that would be a fun matchup, I think, as well. Bottom half of the Midwest, my 6-11, Colorado State against Iowa State. These two would definitely be, I think, an entertaining game. Colorado State, they were at 11 last year in the NCAA tournament and pulled a first round upset. So that was a huge booster for them. Now they're looking like a very strong team under Tim Miles. He's doing a great job there. Iowa State got a big win for them for their resume, as I mentioned, against Baylor. Their numbers are pretty strong, where they're pretty close to being safe. If they don't have any stumbles down the stretch, I think ultimately they'll be okay. The 3-14 matchup that I have is Syracuse against South Dakota State. Syracuse, obviously, one of the strong teams in the Big East. They've been strong all year, 22-4 right now. The Big East is probably going to get 7 teams in for sure, maybe even 8 if Villanova pans out. They're looking very strong. South Dakota State right now leading the Summit League. If you have not seen Nate Wolters play, oh my gosh. The guy put up 53 on IPFW this year. He is a star. South Dakota State made the tournament last year. I think gave somebody a scare in the first round as well. They could be a potential upset team if Wolters plays well. Look out for South Dakota State. They could be dangerous. My 7-10 is NC State going up against St. Louis. St. Louis, speaking of other dangerous teams, that's a dangerous team out of the Atlantic 10 as well. Boy, the A-10 is a lot of dangerous teams. St. Louis, Butler, VCU. The A-10 is a dangerous under-the-radar conference this year. But St. Louis, my word, they just simply took VCU to the woodshed a couple days ago to take the conference lead. They destroyed them by 14 points, 76-62. They are a hard-working team. They're doing a great, great job. NC State is probably going to get in out of the ACC. They're almost at 20 wins. They're looking pretty strong right now, and I think they'll be okay. Their computer numbers are strong. I think they'll be all right. And my 215 in that region is Michigan against Montana. Michigan, the Big Ten, best RPI conference this year. The Big Ten's going to get probably 7 teams in. Don't know about Iowa yet, but the Big Ten's probably going to have to get 7 in. Montana out of the Big Sky, leading the way right now. Weber State's definitely in the discussion. They're kind of close, but Montana right now is the team to beat in the Big Sky Conference right now. All right, that's the Midwest region. Mom tried to call me. Don't know why, but I better take it though. Excuse me for a moment.
Well, we are going to go back and talk more about quarterbacks later on today. We're going to sit down with USC's Matt Barton, and we'll have that for you coming up later on SportsCenter, Jake. All right, thank you, guys. We're Kevin Garnett.
Okay. All right. Nothing major, thankfully. Okay. So moving on. Now to the West region. West region, Florida's my number one. They're my fourth number one team out of the SEC. Again, that Missouri loss, not huge to them, but they're still a very strong team, very well coached, very talented overall. I would have them taking on the winner of the other play game in the 16 line between Robert Morris and High Point. These two teams have kind of jumped up into the conference lead in their respective conferences. Robert Morris out of the Northeast, they leapfrogged Bryant University to get to the top spot. Robert Morris has usually been a tournament staple every year. They've kind of been the big team that gets in. And High Point, get this, has never made the NCAA tournament. So this would be huge for them if they were to get in coming out of the Big South. So that would be my other play-in game. My 8-9, boy, this would be a fun one if this were to happen. Oklahoma against UCLA. These two, Oklahoma's computer numbers are solid, 18 RPI, 4 of strength of schedule, 17-8. They should be okay from the Big 12. They've got a couple good wins. And UCLA, yeah, they've been up and down all year, but you know what? They are a very fun team to watch as well. That would be an awesome, awesome matchup. 5-12 matchup, I have Pittsburgh going up against Boise State. Again, Boise State, kind of one of those close teams in, kind of debatable. They have a couple good wins, but again, their numbers are kind of definitely on that bubble line. But I think what they've been doing of late is really good, so I have them in right now. Pitt, again, the Big East is going to get a ton of teams. Pitt looks solid. They have enough quality wins. I think Pitt will be okay. They're a 20-win team, so they'll be okay. And my 4-13 match would be Wisconsin against Stephen F. Austin. Get this, Wisconsin, 6 top 50 wins. 6. I mean, that is huge. So Wisconsin definitely. But the problem is when it comes to tournament, usually Wisconsin kind of doesn't make a deep run. They kind of fade. They lose to somebody they shouldn't lose to or don't play a good game. So definitely They got to live up to those expectations. Stephen F. Austin this year has been rolling through the Southland. I think they made it out of the Southland last year. They're usually the team that comes out of there, at least of late. So they have a bracket buster game tonight too, I believe, or at least this weekend. Who do they play? They play Long Beach. I want to say they play Long Beach State. But Stephen F. Austin out of the Southland, 22-3, good record. Bottom half of the West, I have 6-11, Cincinnati against Cal. Cal, pretty much to me, should be in now. They look like a tournament team after that thrilling win over Oregon last night or the night before. They look like to me like a tournament team. They've had a surge of great wins of late. I think that's their fourth top 50 win this season. Cal looks really, really good right now. And Cincinnati, again, the Big East, again, is going to get a lot of teams in the field. The numbers are just strong across the board. The Big East is going to get a lot of high seeds, I think. My 314 is New Mexico against Harvard. New Mexico's numbers are sick out of the Mountain West. RPI of 3, SOS of 5. That's huge. 22-4 record. Harvard will probably end up winning the Ivy League. They have a game and a half lead on Princeton right now. As long as they keep running the table and winning, Harvard should be okay and get the bid again for the Ivy League this year. My 710 is Illinois against LaSalle. Illinois, what a surge they've had of late. To think they went from bubble team with a 2-7 conference record now to a 500 record in a span of just about a week and a half. They're now a 20-win team, 20-8. The numbers are back up there. Illinois should be okay. LaSalle, not safe yet out of the A-10, but again, the fact that the A-10 is so strong as a conference, the fact that they've beaten Butler and VCU this year, the fact that they're almost a 20-win team, LaSalle should be okay in the long run, but not quite Locksville just yet. And my 215 is Gonzaga. There's Gonzaga, 26-2, going up against Long Beach State out of the Big West, 17-9 record there. All right, we're going to take a short break, at least for part one of this video. I'm going to make a part two here real quick, and then I will come right back and put up part two, okay? So we're going to take a short break. That's part one, though.